This video will walk you through the disassembly and reassembly of the Microsoft Surface Pro 9. Before you begin, ensure that your work surface is covered with an ESD-safe, non-marring material. Equip an anti-static wrist strap, ensure your work area is properly grounded and safe, and lastly, make sure you're wearing protective eyewear as a safety precaution. If you're performing any repair that requires removing the display, make sure to remove the rSSD first. Removing the rSSD disconnects the battery from all the other components. If you discover any of the following symptoms during a repair, immediately stop and deliver the device to your variance manager or IT support professional for notification to Microsoft RRT. Burned or melted components on the exterior or interior of the device, melting or heat damage on accessories or peripherals such as power supplies, keyboards, mice, or cables, or a swollen or deformed battery. Lastly, make sure you're using a Microsoft service guide for your specific device and using Microsoft official parts only for any repair that you're performing. The service guide has more detailed step-by-step instructions and clarifications for terms or references you may not be familiar with. To begin disassembly, make sure that your device is powered off and disconnected from the power supply, and then place the device face down on your work surface and open the kickstand to approximately 90 degrees. While bracing the back of the kickstand with your hand, use a 3IP Torx Plus driver to remove the two hinge screws. While grasping both hinges, lower them to about 45 degrees, and then hold your kickstand with your thumb on top and pull the kickstand up and away to free it from the threaded bosses. Firmly hold the chassis in place with one hand and then pull the kickstand with a moderate amount of force until the foam inserts slide out of the device. If the kickstand feels stuck, make sure that the threaded bosses are free and haven't slipped back into their recesses. Inspect the removed kickstand's foam tabs for any damage and make sure that they're complete and show no signs of tearing. If the tabs or pad show any sign they may have torn or left pieces behind in the device, proceed to the chassis replacement procedure. To access the rSSD, begin by pressing down on the divot in the rSSD door to pop it open. Use a 3IP Torx Plus driver to remove the single screw securing the rSSD. When the screw is removed, the rSSD will pop up slightly. Gently grasp it by its sides and pull it out from its socket at about a 15 degree angle. To begin display disassembly, begin by inserting an opening tool to widen the gap between the right speaker mesh and the display. Turn the opening pick around and press it in between the speaker mesh and the chassis, pushing the speaker mesh towards the inside of the device. Repeat this process for the left speaker mesh. To separate the display, we'll be using an opening pick and debonding tool, but we need to make sure that we never insert the pick more than we need to for the next few steps. Measure your opening pick and mark a 2mm depth and an 8mm depth on it. This will help guide you as you slice through the adhesive securing the display. Insert your marked pick into the debonding tool, making sure all lines are visible and facing towards the top of the tool, and then clamp the debonding tool to the edge of your workbench. Using a 3mm hex wrench, adjust the tool to the 2mm mark on your pick. When using the debonding tool, make sure not to insert the pick deeper than instructed for each edge. The 2mm setting should be used for the left, right, and bottom edges of the device. The 8mm setting should only be used on the top edge. Place the right side speaker edge of the device into the debonding tool above the pick, making sure the tip of the pick enters the gap you made in the speaker grill between the display and chassis. Using both hands, slide the right edge of the display through the debonding tool. When you get to the bottom edge of the corner, slowly rotate the device to slide the pick around the bottom right corner of the screen. Next, slide the bottom edge of the display across the debonding tool. Repeat this process for the left side of the device. Adjust the pick height to your 8mm mark, and then place the top left corner of the device into the debonding tool, making sure the pick enters the gap between the display and chassis. Slide the top edge of the device across the debonding tool to cut the final bit of adhesive. Lift each edge of the display gently to make sure there's no remaining adhesive. If you find any, use an opening pick to cut it. Gently lift the top edge of the display and carefully flip it over and lay it down next to the chassis. Using a pair of tweezers, remove the metallic tape from the display cable shield. Next, use your tweezers to remove the shield by inserting them into the inner edge of the shield and pulling it upwards. Insert the flat edge of a spudger under one side of the cable connector and pry it up to disconnect it. and then lift the display up and off. Use an opening pick to remove any remaining speaker mesh from the chassis, and then visually confirm that both have been fully removed. While making sure not to touch the battery, use some high-strength IPA and cotton swabs to clean the perimeter of the chassis and the area around the camera and IR sensors. To disconnect the surflink connector, begin by using your opening tool to release the cable's locking bar. Use the point of a spudger to push the edges of the connector out of its socket, and then use a 3IP Torx Plus driver to remove the two screws securing the surflink connector to the chassis. Peel the surflink cable away from the chassis, making sure not to damage the fan underneath the cable, and then lift it out. Locate the fan ZIF connector on the device and use the point of a spudger to flip up the locking bar, and then slide the cable out of the ZIF connector. Use your 3IP Torx Plus driver to remove the 14 screws securing the thermal module. There are two pieces of metallic tape that need to be removed before we can lift the thermal module out. One piece is along the left side of the module, and the other one is along the top edge. Use an opening tool to gently pry up and loosen the edge of the thermal module copper shield. Carefully lift the thermal module out, making sure not to bend it. It is possible that the shield spring will also come out during this step. Use your spudger to scrape off the thermal material from the system on chip area, and then use some isopropyl alcohol and a lint-free cloth to remove any residual material. Before starting the battery removal process, remove any jewelry, put on gloves and safety glasses, and prepare a bucket of sand in case of a battery event, such as swelling, smoking, puncture, overheating, or fire. To begin, use your spudger to disconnect the battery's press contact, and then use your screwdriver to remove 8 4IP Torx Plus screws and the 1 3IP Torx Plus screw. While holding onto the battery by its plastic frame, lift it out of the chassis, making sure not to bend, twist, or drop it. Using your 3IP Torx Plus driver, remove the two screws securing the button PCB, and then lift the board out. Place your finger over the button power clip, and then use your tweezers to pry the clip up until it pops out. Press the button post to eject the button from the chassis. Repeat this process for the volume buttons. The left speaker is held in place by 3 IP Torx Plus screws, and the right speaker has 2. Remove those screws, and then lift the speakers up and out. Peel the right and left Wi-Fi deck shields up and off using your tweezers, and then use your spudger to disconnect the right and 2 left Wi-Fi deck press connectors. There are 6 3IP Torx Plus screws securing the Wi-Fi deck to the chassis. Remove those, and then lift the Wi-Fi deck up and off. To remove the cameras, begin by using your spudger to disconnect the front camera's press contact from the motherboard, and then use your tweezers to lift the rear camera out of the chassis. Using a cotton swab and some IPA, remove any remaining thermal material from the chassis, and then use your spudger to disconnect the rear camera's cable. There are 2 3IP Torx Plus screws securing the rear camera to the chassis. Remove those, and then use your tweezers to lift it out. To remove the motherboard, begin by disconnecting the 2 antenna cables. Once disconnected, position them so they're clear of the motherboard. Next, remove the 6 3IP Torx Plus screws securing the motherboard to the chassis. Before you attempt to lift the motherboard out, peel back the black metallic tape from its bottom left edge. Once that's free, you can lift the motherboard up from its right side to remove it. The last remaining pieces in the chassis are the 2 Wi-Fi antennas. Use your 3IP Torx Plus driver to remove the screws securing them to the chassis, and then use the flat end of your spudger to gently pry them away. To begin reassembly, use your fingers to place the left and right Wi-Fi antennas into the case, and then use your 3IP Torx Plus driver to reinstall the 4 screws securing them to the chassis. Using both hands, lower the motherboard into place starting from the left side, making sure to align the screw holes with the standoffs in the chassis. Reinstall the 6 3IP Torx Plus screws securing the motherboard to the chassis. Use your fingers or tweezers to reapply the metallic tape on the bottom left of the motherboard to the chassis. Then, reconnect the two Wi-Fi coaxial cables and install some Mylar tape over the Wi-Fi module and coaxial connectors. After cleaning the rear camera lens with a microfiber cloth, use your fingers to gently place the rear camera into the chassis and secure it with two 3IP Torx Plus screws. Place some new thermal material in the same location you found it before, and then place the front camera into the chassis. Using your finger, press down to reconnect the front and rear camera cables to the motherboard, and then clean off any fingerprints or smudges on the front camera with a microfiber cloth. Lower the Wi-Fi deck into place and reinstall the six 3IP Torx Plus screws to secure it to the chassis. Once secured, gently press the two left and one right Wi-Fi deck connectors into place. Reinstall the two camera deck shields by pressing down with your fingers to snap them into place. Place the left and right speakers into place, making sure to align them with the posts in the chassis. And then reinstall the 3IP Torx Plus screws, securing them to the chassis. There are three screws on the left side and two on the right. Insert the volume and power buttons into the chassis, making sure the small location pin on the power button is to the left of the button post when inserting it. Position the button clips with the rubber pads facing the exterior of the chassis, and then snap them into place. Reinstall the button PCB and secure it to the chassis using two 3IP Torx Plus screws. Important: do not reuse the old battery when performing repairs. Always use a new battery when the old battery has been removed from the device. Warning: bending, twisting, or impacting the battery may result in damage to the battery, damage to the device, and/or personal injury or property damage. Always use two hands when handling the battery, and have a bucket of sand nearby to place the battery into in the event of a fire. Only handle the new battery with the plastic loops that come attached to the new battery. Verify all removed screws are accounted for, and then with gloved hands, inspect the areas for any debris in the chassis, paying close attention to the magnetized areas. Then gently lower the battery into place. Secure it with 8 4IP Torx Plus screws and the final 3IP Torx Plus screw, and then inspect the battery to verify it's in good condition. There should be no punctures, swelling, or deformations. Finally, press down to reconnect the battery cable to the motherboard. You should hear an audible snap. Align the thermal module and fan with the screw holes on the motherboard, making sure not to bend or twist it, and then secure it in place with 14 3IP Torx Plus screws. Insert the fan cable into the ZIF connector on the motherboard and then lock it into place by pressing down on the connector latch. Insert the surfling port at a 30 degree angle and press it into place. Secure it using two 3IP Torx Plus screws. The magnetized port may attract the screws. Press the cable back into place over the fan and then use your fingers to reconnect the surfling cable and secure the locking bar. Carefully inspect the internal area of the chassis for any foreign objects or loose screws, and verify that the battery has no signs of damage. Then, lay out new display adhesive and replacement speaker grills in the correct position. Clean the chassis along the display adhesive bonding surface with some high-strength isopropyl alcohol, and let it dry for at least 30 seconds before reapplying new adhesive. When you're ready, apply 4 new strips of adhesive to the chassis by removing the clear aligner and carefully placing them. Leave the blue liner on for now. Remove the protective liner from a replacement speaker grill and align it with the display speaker opening. The speaker mesh has 3 areas of mesh offset to one side. Place the mesh facing towards the bottom edge of the device, and the section of solid adhesive should face the top edge. Once it's in place, use the edge of a plastic card to press the mesh into place for about 10 seconds to activate the adhesive, and then remove the blue liner. Repeat this process for the other side. While supporting the display with your hand, align the display's cable to its socket on the motherboard, and then press it into place. Next, install a new shield over the cable connector. Place a new metallic tape strip on the shield and thermal module. While holding the display, remove all the blue liners, exposing the adhesive. Align the display with the bottom edge first, and then lower it into place. Make sure the glass fits flush in the chassis and doesn't rest anywhere on top of the chassis lip. The next few steps will cover display bonding, and there are a couple of ways to successfully bond your display to the chassis depending on the tools available to you. If you're using ruck weights, start with your device screen side up on your work surface and then place a bonding frame on top of it, making sure the cutouts align with the power and volume buttons. Place a foam pad on top of the bonding frame, and then add the 32 kg ruck weight on top of the foam, letting it sit for at least 2 minutes. If you're using steel shop bags, start by inserting your device into the bonding frame and flipping it over display side down onto a foam pad on your work surface. Add the shop bags to the top of the foam pad. Their weight should equal 32 kilograms. Let the weight sit for at least 2 minutes. Inspect the display for scratches, cracks, gaps, and flushness with the chassis. To reinstall the rSSD, slide it into its socket on the motherboard at a 15 degree angle, and then secure it with a single 3IP Torx Plus screw. Slot the top of the rSSD door into the chassis and press down to secure it. Flip the device over, position the hinges at about a 45 degree angle, and then gently slide the kickstand tabs about 3/4 of the way into their slots, and then slightly rotate the kickstand about 5 degrees to catch the outer lip of the hinge. The tabs should slide in easily. Excessive force may crumple them. Reseat the threaded bosses into their recesses, and then grasp the hinges and open the kickstand about 90 degrees. Apply some Loctite activator to the hinge screws and a drop of thread locker in each screw hole, and then use your 3IP Torx Plus driver to reinstall new hinge screws. Fold the kickstand down, remove any plastic if present, and then verify that its edges line up with the case and there are no obvious gaps. With the device reassembled, power it on and run SDT to ensure all functions and features operate as expected.